My name is Pieter Jan Efkens. I'm a Cisco champion since 2017. I've been working with network and IT for already 20 years. And I'm currently working as a lead consultant with YaWorks. YaWorks is a knowledge company providing expert knowledge on storage, networking, virtualization, cybersecurity and automation to customers. So we're not a Cisco partner, but we're providing our knowledge to the customers. And in this session, I'm going to give three tips about implementing software-defined access and DNA center in an existing brownfield environment. But before I continue, can I have a show of hands who is a system engineer or a system administrator? Hopefully 8, 10. And who is a manager, sales? Roughly 25% as well. So there are probably also some designers, architects in the room. Okay. Thanks. So, about the customer. It's a large ICT service provider in the national government. And they provide ICT services for roughly 6 to 8 departments in the Netherlands, national departments. And they also provide network services for buildings in the Netherlands and worldwide. And to give you some numbers, there are 400 locations worldwide, roughly 100 in the Netherlands, 2600 switches, 2200 access points, a couple of wireless LAN controllers, so roughly 145,000 endpoints on an average day that are connected to that network. And I've been working with the Compass team, who's responsible for the local area network, the wireless and the wide area network, connecting all these devices to data centers. And they've done that in a multi-tenancy environment. Is everybody familiar with what a multi-tenant environment is, what multi-tenancy is? I do see some question marks. So multi-tenancy means that you are using a shared physical infrastructure and using logical components to separate these tenants, these user groups from each other. The best example of a multi-tenant environment is the cloud. If somebody uses Office 365, for example, they have their own virtual email environment, but it's running on a shared infrastructure. So your neighbor could be using Office 365 on that same hardware as well, but it's logically separated, and that's multi-tenancy. And in the campus network, they're running it with a staff of 35 persons, and they do most of the things on box by hand using change procedures. And that probably sounds familiar. Who's doing on box management today still or usually? Exactly. And it's also a very dynamic driven organization. So the customer, the will to please for a customer is very high. A lot of custom solutions, custom applications, and not like the cloud where you have standard features and standard functions. But to be honest, I know the OSI layer model, and the network engineers in this room will probably know them as well. But if I talk to an IT manager, he doesn't know anything about an OSI layer or the network itself. So I use the example of a building to explain how the network is working. So at the bottom of an enterprise, you have your wired and wireless connection. So that's just your cable or your wireless connection to the access point. It all connects to switches, controllers, and routers. So that's your local area network. It's local to the branch location and it's there. And you need these services like DNS to translate your IP, your domain name to an IP address, DHCP, for providing the proper and the right IP address for that specific endpoint, security, because we all have seen malware, and those who don't have malware, but they just don't know it yet. Firewall, you need the security as your network infrastructure as well, and of course the wide area network or the internet to connect to your enterprise application. That could be on-premise, data center, or in the cloud, or a mix. But if one of these elements is having an incident, it's not working. And that's basically what the operations team nowadays are doing. They're basically responding to incidents, like a firefighter responding to a fire incident. And they're all busy working, responding to these incidents. For example, a customer sends a report in and he says, well, I cannot connect to the wireless network. It's always the network, isn't it? Well, he forgot to mention he just bought an HP laptop with Windows 10. And well, that's not a good marriage with wireless, to be honest. Or he has a connection, but the application is in the downtime. But it's still the first call comes into the network. So the network guys really start to troubleshoot and see which element is working and which element is not working. So they're really busy. And now let's get back to these numbers. 144,000 endpoints with a staff of 35 employees. That means they're managing 1,400 endpoints per FTE. 137 network devices per FTE. That's already an awesome number. But it's going to explode. We all know about IoT. It's a fact. The number of connected devices will grow exponentially. It's already happening. I know of environments where the escalator has an IP address, where the elevator has an IP address and a SIP phone to monitor if something is wrong. And a SIP phone is actually going to call to the network, to the central environment, to have a call in case of an emergency. But the lights will get an IP address, the aircraft, everything will get an IP address. So there will be an exponential growth of connections in your environment, also in the network, in the enterprise. So if I take that back, and let's say you get 750,000 endpoints on your network in the coming 2-3 years, it's going to happen. You would need a staff 160 persons to manage with the same index. And that's not going to happen because we cannot find that staff. Network engineers are scarce and you cannot pay for them because we all want to do more with less. So there's need to change. Because if we take the same 35 staff, we need to manage 25,000 endpoints per staff member and not 4,800 and 600 network devices. So there's a need to change. But the operations team is working. They're right up to here in the work. They will never be able to change. Because everybody, that's human behavior, will not change if they're under stress level. They just go on and go on. They're not able to take a step back. So my first tip is gain visibility before you can gain control. And how do you do that? Well, we're doing that with DNA Center. DNA Center has a feature called Assurance Mode. And with Assurance Mode, you can gain visibility in your network. It's not using SNMP and syslog, it's using telemetry to get data from the network. So you get insight. And it has roughly 100 checks from the telemetry in the network. 66 of them are already in there for wireless. So a sticky client or a client that's not connected to the network, it's already there. And DNA Center can summarize that in area. So I've put a couple of slide examples in here. And I should have a pointer. There you go. And it's not visible. But you can see that from all the sites we have clients, only 67% is connected to the network. And we have a major problem in the Netherlands because the wireless network is down. So we have a problem in the Netherlands. So we already know if an incident comes in from the Netherlands and it's a wireless device, we know it's network related. But for the US, for example, it's a client related issue, not a network related issue. So DNA Center is used to provide that visibility. And although the release notes say you need modern OS for that, you can also use it on legacy switches as well. It will then use SNMP, syslog, and NetFlow, but you will get that visibility. And with that visibility, it means that people get time available, resources to respond faster on incidents, so they have time available. Use that time to create a lab environment, to create a proof of concept. And then as an external partner, do a step back. Because in my experience, a lot of organizations use project to implement technology. And the project team selects a tool. And then once the project is finished, basically the tools are thrown over the fence all the way up to the operations team and they just have another tool that they need to work on. And the tool doesn't do everything as it's supposed to be, so they have a problem and a multitude of tools. Since DNA Center and software-defined access is really for the operational group, make sure that the organization has the time and the trust in the tool. And you can use a test environment for that, either a proof of concept, and if you don't have the hardware, you can use dCloud. Is anybody familiar with dCloud? Some? dCloud is the demo cloud environment from Cisco. Every technology from Cisco is available on dCloud. So just go to dcloud.cisco.com, log in with your CCO credentials, and you can prove and test that technology. If it's not there, contact your account manager or your system engineer who will be able to provide a lab for you. And use those resources in that lab environment to allow the IT operations to learn and trust DNA Center. Because that way the team starts to use the tool. And that would be my tip too. As an external, be supportive to the IT operations staff. Do not mandate a tool for IT operations. They need to trust and support and use the tool. And once you do that and you have your time reduction and you support it, you can facilitate IT operations in DNA Center with the use of it and be honest with the operation staff. DNA Center is in development. It's already released in November, and there's an intermediate release this month, and in March and in July there will be a next release with new features. So failure in a proof of concept and a new tool is an option. Be honest. If something is not there yet, you can build it. DNA Center has a bunch of APIs, so you can talk to it as well. You can write your own apps on DNA Center as well. Just get some developers and do the work. Important thing is gain trust in the tooling. Now, shadow IT. Who is not familiar with shadow IT? Everybody's familiar. Great. So I don't need to explain that shadow IT is just there. It's a fact of life. Everybody's using apps that are not governed by IT and IT staff. But digitalization is a top priority for every C-level management that's out there. And what is digitalization? Digitalization is the alignment of business and IT. So they need to understand each other and they can support each other. So 1 + 1 = 3. And initially it will be supporting technology, but then the data will support the business process, and eventually it will actually turn around and IT will govern the business processes. And the best example for that is autonomous cars and car driving. Because we first had our safety systems like ABS, and then we had our consultancy or our extra support systems like LaneKeep Assist, and now Tesla and all the other car manufacturers are using self-driving cars. Self-driving cars, business processes, digitalization. But hey, other customers ask, why is my IT taking so long? Because in the cloud I can get an application in 5 minutes or even 5 seconds. Why does it take 5 months for my internal IT to get that application? And that's because usually in the campus network everything is special. Every application needs its own VLAN, its own IP address, its own access list, its own load balancing. So every single port on the network environment is configured non-standard. And non-standard means I cannot automate. And I need that huge amount of staff to configure and manage my network. It's a huge impact. Well, if you use a central policy like a Cisco iServer or another radio server, you can use that for network access control, which is important anyhow, and implement VLAN assignment and access list assignment from that central policy. You can use ICE, that's easy, but you can also use any other radio server that's out there. And that way you can create a standard configuration of your access points. And that means, I'm getting into tip 3, you can only control after you have implemented automation. And how do we start with automation? Relatively easy. We have now time and trust in the team. We can use DNA Center's plug and play, existing technology for MAPEG-EM, to provision new environments. And we can use the software image management, SWIM, from DNA Center to automatically upgrade software on switches and wireless LAN controllers. And how DNA Center does it is quite unique, because it's actually using network profiles. And a network profile is the configuration of a specific area of a building together with an image. So if I need to upgrade, I just need to assign that specific image to that area, and DNA Center will do the rest. Hey, the team gets more work. So the team will reduce the workload, and the tool will do the boring work for you. Because we don't want to upgrade 600 switches after a security incident. At least I don't, but some others might. And then you start to roll out DNA Center with PNP and SWIM on the small side, and you grow that further until all the way your network is there. And because you're doing it step by step, the automation and the control will increase step by step. And as a result, you can start challenging now the team to think differently. Because I'm a network engineer, 20 years in network, if somebody says to me I need to isolate the one single network to the other one, I'm automatically thinking VLANs. And I think everybody here in the room that does networking will think in VLANs as well. But with software-defined access, you don't do that. You're working on virtual networks. The VLANs are gone. Layer 2 is gone on a software-defined network. But that's a change. So my key takeaways is that implementing software-defined access to do that intent-based networking, which was explained in the keynote, is a journey. And it's a journey with change also in organization. It's not a technology which I can just buy and deploy. It's also thinking differently in how I support my customer and my organization and the end users. And to do that, you need to reduce the loads in your environment, in the IT team. And then make the IT team operate the tool and gain trust in the tool. And only when you have time to think differently, you can start challenging and do start on software-defined access.
After the implementation of all this new technology, how many people are running this today?
DNA Center?
Yeah, and you're in Netherlands.
DNA Center is rather new. It was there are already a couple of extended field trials from Cisco from, I believe, June last year. And the general availability was in November. So some companies are already implementing it, and we're one of the first customers using DNA Center.